wrong, Robin? Tired? Dizzy?
I had a strange feeling, Batman. As if visions of sugar plums were dancing in my head.
They should be, Boy Wonder. It's almost Christmas. Ho, 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 ho.
Welcome to Gotham City, Mr. Claus.
Why, call me Santa Claus, Batman. Everybody else does. Say, you tell me where the Batcave is and I'll leave a little present in your stocking.
If you can't trust Santa, whom can you trust? We can't tell you here, Mr. Claus, but we'll telephone you at the North Pole on the Bat phone.
Good, good. I'll get to the Bat Cave if I have to slide down a Bat pole instead of a chimney. Merry Christmas!
Merry Christmas, Santa.
And say hello to those 8 tiny reindeer for us.
I will. Merry Christmas! Merry Christmas, everybody!
Jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse open sleigh. Hey!
Jingle bells, Batman smelt, Robin laid an egg. The Batmobile lost the wheel, and the Joker got away.
Welcome back, citizens,
to an all-new episode of the Batcave Podcast.
It's your old Bat Chum John and Screw here. And this is it. We're on our final entry in terms of our look at Batman, Detective, World's Finest, Waving the Bowls, and trying to fit them into Batman 1966. We've got two more episodes in the 12 Days of Batmas altogether. We'll talk about that at the end. Now, we got a little bit out of order. We've kind of like gotten to the end of our run. We're going to snap back and go back to the beginning, the early days, 1943, with another character I always said would make a perfect addition to Batman 66. And joining me to cap this all off is An old friend of the podcast. You've heard his voice here. It's been a while, though, since you've heard. Please welcome back author Keith R.A. DeCandido. Hey, Keith.
Hello.
So, you picked the Cavalier.
Yes. As you said, the Cavalier is perfectly suited for Batman 66. He's a guy who dresses like he just wandered out of a Renaissance festival. So it suits the visual entertainment value of the show, which was always big on, you know, brightly colored weirdos.
Yes.
You know, he had the poofy shirt. He's got the gloves. He's got the big hat. He's got the ridiculous mustache. All of this is stuff that would be perfect for Batman 66. And his crimes are ridiculously eccentric. In the comic book, he basically seemed to be focused on old sports memorabilia. Initially, it seemed to be just as a means to an end to do a robbery, but then the robbery was of more sports memorabilia. So it's a sufficiently eccentric crime that it also fits perfectly with the 66 Batman. So it gives the opportunity for a sword fight. And it is my personal opinion that there is no story on this earth that cannot be improved with a sword fight.
That was always one thing that was very disappointing in the 66 series. There's an episode with Batman and Freddy the Fence.
Freddy the Fence, sir.
And you think, okay, here we go. We're going to get a sword fight. No, just a quick thrust from Batman, and suddenly one of the greatest fencers of all time is disarmed.
Well, the Freddy the Fence also wasn't the main bad guy either. That was a Catwoman episode. So. True.
What I also do like about this, as you say, the eccentricness of it all, because it's a means to an end, and there's sports-related crimes that leads to the big crime of the collection. But here's the other part of it that's so eccentric. There's no value to the collection other than to the person who owns it. It's not even like we're going to find out afterwards, and I'm ransoming it back for a million dollars or something. No, I just want this thing he's got that meant something of value, and I'm not going to give it back. That's interesting.
For that matter,
that's
we
don't see that.
Even,
we don't see that.
The first thing he steals is the kid's baseball, ratty old baseball that was autographed by, you know, somebody who was like an amateur player or something, and then later owns a sporting goods store for the purpose of forging a note, which makes sense. But, you know, he could have given the ball back to the kid because the kid obviously wanted the ball back. Mm-hmm. But, you know, he was a schmuck. And he's the bad guy. You know, so. The other thing he's got that also makes him a perfect fit for Batman 66 is a seemingly infinite supply of hench thugs.
Yes.
Yes.
He had like 12 of them or something, you know, all piled into the car driving around. But
well, as we're going to find out later with other issues, we don't find this out now. He's a well-to-do off man himself, like Bruce.
Right.
You know, which again would have been just so wonderful because if you had the whole peeling of layers of this guy, that's what I found interesting as I'm going through and reading his other stories as well. You have a. We'll talk about the titles, but he is on par with Batman in terms of his abilities and in terms of his access to cash.
Right, right. You could have even, you know, if you're doing it as a two part episode of the show, you could even introduce him as, you know, a colleague of Bruce's there at some, you know, millionaire function or other, you know, or, you know, a fundraiser or a charity event or some damn thing. You know, we've seen Bruce hobnob with fellow rich people in the past. In other episodes, there was the I can't remember which one it was now. The one with the baseball game and stealing diamonds and such. There were
Mr. Freeze.
Yeah. And then also the one with Egghead and the exchange with the natives who they bought Gotham City from, where they had to present the pelts.
Yes.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And for that matter, the other millionaires we saw in the Minerva in the last episode of the third season. So, you know, Bruce hanging out with other millionaires is something they were willing to do in the past, and they could do it again very easily with this guy. Mm-hmm. And then we find out at the end of the teaser or whatever that he's truthfully this, you know, this bad guy, and then we go from there.
Right. So let me ask you this.
Because
in the end of the comic, he gets away.
He gets away.
Right.
We never have that in the 66 show.
We
show that possibly they're dead. Riddler and Catwoman being those two. Where they get away with it and such. But they're thought to be dead, and then later on we find out they're not. But okay, there's never a case of the bad guy gets away, and kind of loses, which is really what happens here in the end.
Yeah, and you're right. There was no way they'd do that on the TV show. He would get captured for sure.
See, because what I was thinking was like, wouldn't it be cool if you could pull a, what is it, Detective 27, all the way back to the beginning, and at the end of the episode, he does get away, and then he's, we find out, because like you could bookend it, the beginning with all the millionaires and such meeting, and he's one of them, and then at the end, wouldn't Batman be surprised if he found out that the Cavalier was, you know, the way Bruce does it, how wouldn't the Commissioner be surprised if he found out that
it
was Bruce Wayne?
Yeah, but that wouldn't fit the mode of Batman 66 at all. He always has to, you know, even he has to be victorious in some way or other, either from the bad guy appearing to be deceased or capturing him. And most of the time it was capturing him, you know, and which is fine, you know, that there's no reason, especially, you know, if it's going to be a one and done thing as it would be here. Why you can't have him be captured at the end.
Mm-hmm. It's interesting too because so far a lot of these stories that I've done with everybody, the pacing leading up to what would be the cliffhanger to go from part one to part two works well. You could almost just do that whole part there as part one, but then part two, because the cliffhanger always seems to happen towards the end, so that the rest of the story is rushed, and now we got to kind of a little bit. For me, I was looking at it and said, well, the whole thing where Batman and Robin meet them at the train area there, and they're having that fight, and Robin would get knocked out, and they'd be like lying there on the train, and Batman comes to first and manages to pull him away. Ta-da, and they make a time. Okay, a little bit of a cheat, but
for that matter, there was a version of that earlier in the story when Robin fell and was knocked down and fell in the street and was about to get run over by a car. Yeah, you could combine those two basically.
Right.
You know, right. You're right. I think it would work better with the train.
Yeah.
Assuming they had the budget for a train. Mm-hmm. But have them both fall, you know, do that bit where they chase him down and have the confrontation on the train tracks and then, you know, Cavalier manages to knock them both out. Because the only time Batman and Robin ever lose a fight is when you're toward the end of the half hour of part one. and then Batman manages to wake up first because of his mighty Batmanness or whatever. Sorry, I have a cat. the cat has just jumped into my lap. Probably heard us talking about Catwoman and was like,
and got intrigued.
Yeah.
Because things moved way too fast in the comic that you couldn't just do a straight lift adaptation. You have to add elements there. Like you said, it's the baseball. The baseball.
Baseball.
Toy bat. It turns out that the toy bat has a key inside. It's that area there. I mean, there has to be another element where I don't know, a confrontation that Cavalier gets away or something. And then finally, okay. Now the key leads to the safe. The safe tells us that this is where the collection is, and such. And then the final confrontation in the store, which is that's a great fight at the end.
Yeah, and you'd want to have, I mean, you'd want to take advantage and do like an Adventures of Robin Hood style or Princess Bride style sword fight, you know, between Batman and Cavalier, which would last longer than the one than the comic did, because have it be. That was only like a page. Whereas you can draw out the fight between Batman and the Cavalier, assuming that, you know, Adam West, or at least Adam West's stunt double, was able to, you know, fake it with the sword. I don't think you even need to add an extra clue to it. I think it's just what leads them up to the part where they're chasing them to the train station still works. And then, you know, maybe take it longer to figure out what the key is for. You know, not have that happen until the beginning of part two.
Right.
You know,
right.
And I loved just a little touch. Cause that also is a very Batman 66 thing to happen. Is having Batman lecture Robin about the trick of having it unscrew in the other direction in order to prevent people from stealing it.
Yes.
Which, you know, a chance for a teachable moment with Robin, which is always appreciated.
So. Yes. Yep.
Yes. Yep.
There was one thing was I thought, like, it just thought, caught like, me, just caught you know, me.
You know,
I'm assuming it means as another euphemism, but Robin calling the Cavalier a rainbow. Yeah.
I'm sure that was because of all the different colors in his outfit.
I'm sure that's what it is.
Of course, Of course, Robin's one to talk, given his outfit. But
right.
We do view from the bridge in the junior year, and one of the characters refers to another as a weird.
And of course, the kids are all like, "What does that mean, Mr. Drew?" I'm like, "Okay, notice how the character is sort of behaving in some ways, and then how it might chafe against masculinity or the views of masculinity. What could a weird be?
Yeah.
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 So yeah, that just struck me that I'm thinking that's an odd thing to say anyway. Just in general. I guess his flamboyant nature, but that's the nature of any of these swashbucklers.
Yeah.
Which he styles himself after.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. One other thing I think you could do to add to some of this is show us a little bit more of the Cavaliers, you know, like his home, which is like full of all sorts of weird medieval memorabilia or something, or weird sports memorabilia for that matter. I mean, it's a little bit more to establish the character, even have that be the case of his secret identity is somebody who's always watching, you know, like watching the Adventures of Robin Hood or something, you know,
right.
In his private screening room, cause he's rich and rich people have those things. So.
Yeah. The comic book does eventually have them discovering his collection of collections.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
But you could incorporate it earlier on. Absolutely.
Yeah.
By the way, meant to fill in the info here. It's Detective Comics. If you're looking to play the game, issue 81,
September
24th, 1943. The writer was Don Cameron. Pencils by Bob Kane. Inker by George Roussos. With thanks to Mike's Amazing Worlds, the website. I'll put the links in. If anything you need to know about comic books, release dates, writers, when they'll appear next.
Right.
That takes,
you'll pardon the expression, some detective work, since the only actual name on this thing is Bob Kane's.
Yes.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And not only an autograph at the bottom of the first page.
Yeah.
The distinctive B-O-B. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it's they weren't big on credits in those days. I forgot actually that George Roussos was his career goes back to the '40s. Mm-hmm. He was one of Marvel's standbys in the '60s during the early days of Marvel's superhero revolution in the '60s. He worked, he did both inks and colors, I think.
Right.
On a lot of the books in the '60s.
And the Cavalier will come back a couple more times. He comes back in Batman 22, Detective 89, and then finally his last appearance is Batman 26. But he does come back in the 70s in the Earth One version of Batman.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I don't know if he's
somebody who's
been picked up for
a revival at some point.
Well, that's what I was going to say. I don't know if he's ever been picked up by Brave and the Bold. I forget because I know some of the ones we've talked about in these episodes here, they've gotten Brave and the Bold's notice.
Notice.
Yeah.
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 Yeah. Okay, so let me ask you. The Cavalier.
The Cavalier.
Who have you got in mind?
I've got two different people in mind, both of whom are technically movie stars who may or may not have lowered themselves to do television, but either of them would have been perfect for the role, you know, around 1969 or so, when our, you know, non-existent fourth season would have happened. Either Christopher Lee or Oliver Reed.
Okay.
I think Reed would have been a little bit better because Oliver Reed would have been able to pull off the secret identity more. Christopher Lee, you know, I mean, Christopher Lee at that point was best known for playing, you know, bad guys and like Dracula and such. And I think he would have been a little, having said that, it's Batman 66. So being obvious isn't really a crime. But I think Reed would have been just a little bit better, but either of them would have been perfect. And both of them could do the sword fighting. That's part of the appeal. I'm sure some people would think Errol Flynn, but he had retired from acting at that point.
He was dead.
Oh, was he dead by then?
By 59. Okay. He'd retired in 57. He was gone in 59.
Oh, geez. Okay.
Yeah.
For some reason, I thought he lived longer than that. But I'm sure Errol Flynn was who the creators had in mind when they were writing it in 43.
Oh, sure.
But yeah, either. I mean, Oliver Reed, you know, of course, probably the role that's the best comp for this would be the Four Musketeers.
Mm.
And ironically, the person who taught him how to fence was Christopher Lee. So, which is why I thought of either one of them. But you know, Lee was a very talented fencer, so he would have been perfect for that too, and he could have done all his own work.
Right. I think Reed would have been a harder get.
Probably, yeah. Mm-hmm. Especially in this era, because he was, you know, this was 69. He was a bona fide movie star, and it was before 69 was before he started really like drinking himself into insensibility. So he would have been probably more fussy about the roles he would have chosen. On the other hand, he might have thought it would have been cool.
True.
As so many others did. So
I've got a couple here I want to float past you and see what you think. One is totally ridiculous, but I'm only saying it because of the connection it would have with Frank Gorshin. And that being Burt Lancaster.
Yeah.
He was 53 at the time. And Frank Gorshin had done a whole bit with where Burt Lancaster, and I forget who the other one was, were Batman and Robin.
Ah.
And Lancaster was Batman. So he's like, Robin. Yeah, he's doing that whole thing. And it's dead on with Gorshin. It's beautiful. Douglas Fairbanks Jr.
Right. Yeah.
57.
Yeah. That's the thing. Yeah. Reed and Lee were both, I think, younger than that at the time.
Yes.
Mel
Ferrer.
Mel Ferrer.
Oh, yeah.
49.
49.
Right.
Okay, but now here's the wild one.
Again,
Batman was either good about getting those folks who were like, you know, kind of slowing down in their careers, but were still well known. And it's like, wow, you know. Or getting the real young up and comers. Harvey Keitel.
Huh.
He was 26. He only had a few credits. He had done Hogan's Heroes and Dark Shadows.
Right.
But
I mean, the only reason I think that wouldn't is that they weren't really, I mean, especially after the first season, they didn't cast a lot of unknowns in those roles. I mean, they were going for people who were recognizable for the most part.
True.
You know, Keitel is somebody who they would have hired to play like one of the hench thugs or maybe the guy who owned the guy who autographed the baseball. The guy who had the autograph baseball rather or who autographed it, whatever. Either like the father of the kid or the guy who owned the sporting goods store. That either one of those I think would have been more likely to hire someone like Keitel for.
You're right.
I part of why I'm thinking Oliver Reed is because I just recently watched a movie that came out in 69 called The Assassination Bureau, which had Oliver Reed, Diana Rigg, and Telly Savalas. And it was phenomenal. And Reed plays a talented assassin who runs an assassination bureau where people are they hire them to assassinate bad people. And Diana Rigg basically hires the bureau to assassinate him. And he decides to take it on because he feels that the organization is getting a little too focused on money and not enough on doing the right thing by killing the appropriate people, just killing who can pay for it. So he wants to clear out the deadwood, as it were. Watching it, I'm thinking, he had both the charm, the good looks, and the physicality, and the sword fighting ability. It's all like perfect for the Cavalier.
Okay. All right.
And it's a great movie, and I strongly recommend it. It's I don't think it's available on streaming anywhere unless you pay for it, but it's just, and it was made in 69, so.
So that was just after On Her Majesty's Secret Service, then, I think.
They both kept that, Diana Rigg and Telly Savalas were in two movies that year, at least.
Yeah.
it was the same year as that, and so they were both filmed in Europe. Assassination Bureau was entirely filmed in Europe as well. So they were probably filmed very close to each other.
Right.
Savalas did a really bad job of putting on a British accent. he pronounced all the words right, like it was privacy instead of privacy, but it was, he still sounded like Telly Savalas. But in any, whoever they got to do it, I think, and God knows there were, especially in the late 60s, there were plenty of actors who had the ability to pull off the fencing parts of it and the sword play, because that's a critical part for this. You know, you really want somebody who can convincingly wield a sword. Now, I have no idea how convincingly Adam West could. It's possible that the Freddy the Fence thing was so curtailed because Adam West was not good with a sword. I don't know one way or the other. I don't know. You know, I mean, he did enough stage work that he might have been in a duel at some point, like in a Shakespeare play or something, but
right
early in his career. But you know, he's also, you know, you can also hire a fencing stunt double, especially for, you know, while he's in the Batman outfit. So.
Okay. So what would your titles for this two-parter be?
Part one would be Crimes of the Cavalier, and part two would be Batman is His Peer.
Yeah.
Which works on two levels, yeah, you know, because it's he's his peer as a swords fighter, and he's a fellow millionaire, and they rhyme. And it means you pick something that rhymes with Cavalier, and you may as well challenge yourself on these rhymes. Mm-hmm. So,
what if there was, at the very end, Batman like sees him being let off, and you know, Robin's there standing next to him, going, "You know, he was a friend," and he's like, "Yes, Robin, you know, there's a lesson too there, but for the grace of God, you know," or something.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. No, you definitely would, you know, want there to be some sort of lesson about how easy it is, you know, for the idle rich to fall into bad habits or whatever. Yeah.
I like it. Anything else about this issue or you know, crafting it into the story overall you wanted to touch on that we didn't cover?
One thing I there was a lot of car chasing in this one. And that's another thing that you know, they could do very easily on the TV show and actually make it more exciting than it was in the comic book, which is the Batmobile chasing the Cavalier's sedan around all over Gotham City or the Hollywood Hills or whatever. But they only did car chases a few times on the show, but that's, you know, they've got this cool car. You may as well take advantage of it.
Right.
And it's a chance to show off what the Batmobile can do. No, but I mean, for that matter, they had to catch up to him. You know, cause initially Batman had to save Robin, from getting run over. And there was one other thing. I just read this like this morning and I forgot, but there was something where they were delaying. Hang on. Oh, right. When he uses his sword to hit a horse-drawn cart that is collecting. Just in case you didn't remember that this was done in 1943, it was a horse-drawn cart that was collecting scrap for victory. It was a scrap metal collector for the war effort. And he zapped the horses, and the horses go all crazy. I mean, I don't know if they could have. That's another thing that may have not been in the budget. And also, of course, obviously in 1969, they weren't collecting scrap for the war effort, but they could have done something similar to that where, you know, just a runaway horse or something that Batman has to heroically leap on and calm down with his ability to do everything. And just, you know, make the horse slow down and then they caught back up to him for that. So that's, you know, there's plenty of time for visual excitement on that, which is another reason why I don't think you need to add another clue. I think the sequence that you've got in the comic book is enough to sustain a two-parter with all the extra. The rest of the time would be filled out with the horse rescue, with the train tracks cliffhanger, and with the big fight in the sporting goods store at the end, with the big sword fight.
The car chases in the series anyway, in general, anything where they were using the back lots.
Yeah. And I was just thinking, yeah, you're in a sporting goods store and you can have some ridiculous, like Robin's going to be fighting the thugs while Batman is doing the sword fight. So on the one hand, you got this elegant sword fight with these two people doing, you know, their lovely sword. And meanwhile, you've got Robin using like soccer balls and baseball bats and such to fight the thugs.
Yeah. Well, okay then. I think we definitely got a strong winner here. I remember, and by the way, I'll put the link as well in the show notes. You can take a look at my original blog post about this in the Batman A Day blog, where I said this would be a perfect 66.
Yeah. Oh, it totally would. Yeah.
Yeah. But before we wrap things up here, Keith, you know, people want to continue the discussion with you. You know, if they want to find out more about your musings on Batman, which you did as well for tour.com.
Yes. Yes.
What's the best way about going about all of that?
The best, go to DeCandido.net, my last name, DeCandido.net. It's a terrible website, although I'm hopefully in 2023 finally going to be able to drag it into the 21st century. But even in the crappy form it's in now, it's a link dump to all the different places you can find me online. I'm on Facebook. I'm on Twitter, for the time being, at least. I'm on Instagram. I am on, I have a channel on YouTube where I read my short fiction, which I started during the recent apocalypse. It's called Crad COVID Readings. I'm actually going to be bringing that back in 2023 as well. Probably like once a month, reading another short story. I have a Patreon, patreon.com/crad, which has movie reviews, TV reviews, excerpts from my works in progress, vignettes featuring my original characters, and a lot of cat pictures. and that helps pay the bill. So please, if you could consider supporting that, it would be greatly appreciated. As you mentioned, I write for tour.com. On tour.com, I did from 2015 to 2017, Holy Rewatch Batman, which includes looks at all the episodes of Batman 66, the movie, and the two more recent animated specials they did. Plus quick looks at a couple other things. And I also was sort of a sidebar to that. I took a look at the Batgirl promo and the Green Hornet, just a general overview of the Green Hornet in one post. And also I was doing both Holy Rewatch Batman and the Star Trek, the original series rewatch, both around the same time in time for both shows, 50th anniversary in 2016. And one of the things I looked at was the 1964 pilot, Alexander the Great, starring William Shatner and Adam West, which did not go to series, which is good, because if it had, the entire face of popular culture would have been completely different if neither Shatner nor West were available for their more iconic roles that started in 66. So so that's on tour.com, where I also write about a bunch of different things, including Star Trek, Stargate, and various screen adaptations of superhero comics. So check that out as well. So, and you can find, I'm very easy to find online. I've also got a blog at on WordPress that I update pretty regularly. So if you want to bug me about the Cavalier comic, feel free to ping me at any of those places.
Absolutely. And you can also, I think you can comment on the Facebook page.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
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 Yeah. So, all right then. Well, that's going to do it for this episode of the Batcave Podcast, folks. I said two more episodes. So tomorrow, the deal is this: Joe Stuber and I get together for the penultimate look at Filmation 1977, in which Penguin and Joker don't team up, but they are featured in the same episode together, actually at odds with each other, trying to run for president of their underworld organization. So we've got that coming up there tomorrow. And then finally, Christmas Day. You've been hearing me talk about this, and Rob Long has been asking me about it every time he appears. Well, we finally sat down, he and I and Jim Beard, and we tore apart Legends of the Superheroes.
Oh, God.
Yes.
Yes.
I assume you kept towels handy to wipe the blood away from your eyes as you were watching.
God. And here's the kicker. It's over 2 hours of the discussion of this. And it's like, why? But you know what? As has been the case, every time there's something bad going on, we always have more fun talking about it than actually watching.
Yes. Well, you'd almost have to.
Yes.
Yes.
Marcia, Queen of Diamonds, Nora Clavicle, we made it work. Egghead and Olga, Kevin Lauderdale, and I had a great old time with it. Hated watching it.
Yes.
But we had fun with it. So stay tuned for that, folks. And then we're going to be taking a break for a couple of weeks to enjoy the holidays. And then we'll be back in 2023 with new episodes. But until then, Keith, once again, thank you so much for doing this.
My pleasure.
And folks, you have yourselves a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year, but I will be talking to you tomorrow with Joe Stuber. Until then, take care.
come what may. Merry Christmas, Mr. Wayne.
Merry Christmas, Albert.
Goodwill toward men.